If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.
Hello and welcome to this week's edition of the Politically Speaking Podcast. I'm your host, Chris McDaniel, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. Joining me in studio is...
Jason Rosenbaum.
And...
Joe Manis, back from vacation.
Yes, and I'm back from sickness as well.
Which is why he's not in the second part of the show,
yes,
folks.
We're doing a two-part
show. But we digress.
We're doing a two-part show with Senator Ryan Silvey. What did I miss, guys?
This is one of the rare times we've had a guest just on one topic.
And he was great.
And he has gained some attention in the last few weeks for putting out a proposal as an alternative to Medicaid expansion, Medicaid transformation or Medicaid reform, what you will.
But it would still, the aim is to allow Missouri to take most
to get
of
up
that
to 138%.
So the Missouri can get that federal money.
And he goes kind of in depth not only about the plan, but also kind of the opposition to the plan and how to potentially overcome it. So we'll get to that a little bit later, but we're going to just babble for at least 13 or 14 minutes here.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Well, let's get to the babbling. It is April 16th, which means that we've had our April quarterly reports.
Yes.
Jason, what did we find?
Well, we found that people raised money, spent money, and have cash on hand.
And have some cash on hand.
But Joe looked at the numbers more closely than I did. So.
Yeah. Well, the main thing is the contest, which is not early, regardless what some may say, for the 2016 governor's race, where you've got Missouri Attorney General Chris Koster, a Democrat, former Republican, who is continuing to burn as far as raising money. He's got over $2 million in the bank, and he raised close to $600,000 this last quarter. Now, the two Republicans, the one who has announced, former State House Speaker Catherine Hanaway.
It must have been the politically speaking bump after appearing on our show.
Right. Raised roughly around, I'm generalizing here. People can go to our website and see the particulars.
Yes. STOPublicRadio.org.
Right. She raised close to $300,000, a little under that, but has about $300,000 in the bank. State Auditor Tom Schweik, a Republican who is expected to possibly run for governor, but who hasn't announced because he's running for re-election this fall, raised a little bit less, roughly around the 250 range, but he has more in the bank, close to 900,000. Now, the bottom line, though, is that you've got a lot of money raising going on, but that so far, Hanaway and Schweik have failed to match Koster's efforts.
Which isn't surprising,
right?
Because Hanaway got into the race a few months ago,
right.
And
correct.
Koster has been raising money for this for 2 or 3 years.
Now, two interesting things is that all three of them have some big contributions, but her and Schweik in particular. Schweik, as we mentioned several months ago, got $100,000 during the quarter from Sam Fox, major businessman based in Clayton.
Right.
And Hanaway, in a little interesting twist, she received $100,000 from Club for Growth, which is a conservative group in Missouri, but frankly, it's generally almost totally funded so far by Rex Ziegfeld, who also gave her $50,000. So basically, she got $150,000 from Rex Ziegfeld.
Do you think Ziegfeld is going to be donating to two candidates in this race? Because he's donated prodigiously to Koster in the past two cycles. Or do you think that he's just going to go with Hanaway this time?
I don't know. That kind of sent a signal that Koster, who has benefited by Ziegfeld's largesse in the past, and who occasionally apparently has dinner with him, may want to invite Ziegfeld to dinner to find out what's going on.
Yeah. Interesting that, Dooley gets a lot of flack for taking money from Ziegfeld. Haven't heard a lot of outcry from Democrats about Koster in recent months.
Now, Koster's quarterly, most of his donations were less than that. However, if you add them all together, about a third of his money that he collected during the quarter came from labor.
Yes.
And then almost as much, not quite, but at least $100,000, came from various health care insurance players in the healthcare industry. So that And then he got his usual amount from fellow lawyers.
Yeah.
But this wouldn't be the first time that Ziegfeld has given to both candidates in a race, right?
Right.
I'm trying to think of the example, though.
I believe he gave to Koster and Martin.
Oh,
yes, he did.
That is true. He did
for the
that
AG's
back
race
in 2012.
And technically, I think he gave to Kinder and Lager, but that was after
there was a large disparity, but he was still giving to both.
Yeah, and I also should note that Koster, one of his strengths is that he always has had a very varied fundraising base, because not only does he get money from all these traditional Democratic groups, he gets money from traditional Republican donors. I mentioned Ziegfeld, but he also has gotten money, I believe, from... Has he gotten money from Sam Fox in the past? I believe he has.
I think early on he has. I'm not sure if he's got any lately, but it's because they share the same stance as far as being in favor of most forms of stem cell research.
He's also gotten money from William Danforth as well.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's just the thing that Republicans are going to have to deal with Koster. I mean, not only does he have an incredible radio voice that's going to be great for ads, but he is very adept at raising money from a diverse
pool of wealthy individuals.
Which are wealthy interests. Are not necessarily wealthy interests, because I wouldn't necessarily say labor unions are wealthy interests, but a varied interest.
Right.
And that means that he's not necessarily dependent on one donor or one sector. So.
And one thing I want to make clear that I mentioned before we went on the air, and I'm highlighting my age again here, but the fact is that regardless of what some other outlets have indicated, this the fact that the governor's race for 2016 is already heating up, at least on the money-raising side, is not new. And you can go back to numerous previous races. Even, in fact, Jay Nixon, right after the 2004 election where Matt Blunt, Republican, had defeated Claire McCaskill, a Democrat, for governor, at the same day of the swearing-in of Matt Blunt, I was over at Nixon's office for his renewed party for his swearing-in for yet another term as AG. He made clear he was already looking at 2008 for governor. So this is 4 years out. That's Nixon, the current governor. And then if you go back to, I consider, the marquee gubernatorial race ever in Missouri history, at least over the last 50 years or so, if you go back to the 92 governor's race where you had five major players, two Democrats, three Republicans, the best-known officials in state politics at the time, that race started several years early. And when you take inflation into account, that race between then-Mayor Vince Schemel, then-Lieutenant Governor Mel Carnahan on the Democratic side, then-Attorney General Bill Webster, who ended up going to prison, Blunt, and then State Treasurer Wendell Bailey. Blunt was then Secretary of State. That contest remains, in my opinion, the most expensive gubernatorial race ever in Missouri history, because if you added all of what they spent, it was around $20 million or more. And if you take inflation into account, that still is well ahead of what has been spent in previous gubernatorial races in Missouri.
Yeah. So I guess we'll go into our second topic.
Yeah. Well, we need to mention, though, the other marquee money raising was for St. Louis County Executive, which was Charlie Dooley and Steve Stenger, the two Democrats who are going to be battling it out for Dooley's job this summer. And basically, they were both close on how much they had in the bank. Stenger has an edge, about $150,000 or so more. And Stenger outraised Dooley, but just by a little bit. Dooley still points to Stenger's personal money that he put in earlier. Stenger's people, though, can also point to the fact that Dooley had a $100,000 contribution just a couple days before the period ended in late March, and it came from Gene Ziegfeld.
I don't understand the criticism about the personal money, because that $100,000 that Stenger put in is still going to buy the same thing that a donation did. I know that they're probably trying to point out that Stenger, you know, is a wealthy means or whatever, but I mean...
You could also argue that it comes with less strings attached.
I don't really understand the criticism. And if you weren't making that criticism against Susan Monty, Claire McCaskill, or, you know, anybody, or Chris Koster,
right,
who self-funded, I don't really know how you can make it against stinger, but I mean, it's campaign season. You're going to find any way to criticize
well,
people.
Well,
that's the key.
What Dooley was trying to contend, I think, is that the fundraising is closer than it may appear. However, the fact that he took $100,000 from Gene Sinkfeld, Rex Sinkfeld's wife, just a few days before the period ended that's included in the counting, that kind of negates some of that. You know, and some of that fight.
Just before we get to our next topic, though, what did Rick Stream's quarterly report look like, Joe? He's the Republican who's intending to run.
He hasn't filed yet. Now, I haven't looked at it, but the last I looked, because he announced after the filing period ended.
Gotcha.
So he doesn't really have to report, frankly, for another 3 months. But Rick Stream, though, figures in our next topic, so I'll let you.
Yes. Now we'll actually get to it. I was premature on my transition. So while Joe was gone, the House did a perfection vote, or kind of a first-round approval vote on right to work, which is a topic that we've talked about ad nauseum on the show.
Correct.
Go back to our archives. You can hear us opine on that. And the final vote count was only 78 votes, and you need 82 in order to get it out of the House.
Correct.
And what was interesting was not only did a lot of Republicans vote against it, I think about
19
voted against it. There were also
11 who walked.
11 who walked or just weren't there for some reason. And it's been interesting to watch this from my perspective, because I think some people that voted against right to work, some Republicans are being kind of treated differently from others. If you're one of the people in the House who is a Republican that represents Jefferson County, I don't think you're seeing any criticism being lobbed that way, because it's kind of expected that they're not going to support right to work.
Because there's so many union people or retirees who live in Jefferson County.
But then there are the St. Charles County Republicans and maybe some of the people in districts that are more Republican and less swingy, so to speak. They're apparently getting pressured up the wazoo to change their vote or to actually vote yes if they didn't end up actually voting in this.
Yeah, I interviewed Chuck Katzenberger yesterday. I should say earlier this week to set the stage here. The House is preparing to have a second vote to come up with the 82, so they need those four extra votes. So there's been a lot of pressure since that vote last week to try to get some people to switch or show up and vote.
Yeah, right.
And I've been getting, as soon as I got back in the United States, I was getting calls from people on both sides saying things, although most of it was off the record. But the bottom line is Chuck Katzenberger, who's a state rep from Lake St. Louis, who is running for the state Senate, did talk to me, and he contended that he's been getting a lot of pressure. He was among those who had voted no. As I said, he's also running for the state Senate in St. Charles, and as Jason and others have pointed out, St. Charles also has become a home for many labor activists, members, and retirees.
Now, on that, I am not really sure voting no on right to work will hurt any of these people. If anything, especially if like you're in Jeffco or a union-heavy district, I think you have to do it, or you're a dead man or dead woman walking. In that race, though, I think it could have an impact, because with the confluence of labor support in St. Charles County, I do think it matters, but in that particular instance,
it's a three-way race.
It's a three-way race, okay. And Vicki Schneider, who recently gave her campaign $245,000, also has labor support. So I'm wondering if Katzenberger and Schneider may end up splitting the labor vote, which may give an advantage to Bob Onder, who I haven't heard him talk a lot about right to work, but maybe we'll run from the right and get those type of
Well,
voters.
Bob Onder, who's working on Bob Onder's campaign? One of Jones' top aides. I mean, the House Speaker Tim Jones' top aides. And House Speaker Tim Jones has made getting right to work through the House a key issue. So the assumption is that whether Onder is saying anything or not, that he likely is sympathetic to the pro-right to work forces. Now, he may not, but I'm just saying that's the perception that's out there.
Yeah.
Now, Katzenberger said that he has gotten a lot of pressure to either change his vote or at least walk.
Yeah.
He's been told, look, we won't take it against you if you just walk next time and just don't vote against right to work. But he said, for the record, that he will vote against right to work again if it comes up on the floor.
It is kind of notable, though, that St. Charles County has become such a hotbed for union activity that Republicans almost uniformly voted no.
Well, you can read up on that at stlpublicradio.org, and you can read Joe's stories about all of the money raising that's been going on. But we'll now get to the second half of our show with Senator Ryan Silvey. Jason, tell us a little bit about the senator.
Well, Senator Ryan Silvey is a former House budget chair. He was one of the youngest people, I think, ever to get to that point, which is a very prestigious, powerful post. I see him kind of as one of the rising stars in the Republican Party. He's not only somebody who can probably defend his position pretty eloquently, but is willing to do it pretty aggressively, as you'll kind of see. I should also point out, since we had to cut this because of technical problems, Senator Silvey is one of the few Missouri legislators who knows and is very good at the video game Rock Band. As he said on our show, he usually plays the drums because he plays guitar in real life. And as a person who can't play drums in that game to save my life, I do salute the senator for his ambitiousness.
We'll be right back.
Well, before we get into any questions, just briefly kind of tell us a little bit about yourself and why you got into politics.
Sure. I actually got interested in politics in high school, in debate class. In debate, you're presented a problem and you've got to come up with a solution and then convince the judge that your solution is right or that the other person's solution is wrong. And at the basest level, that's what the legislature is.
Key question for our listeners. Where did you go to high school?
Oh, well, I'm in Kansas City, so I went to Oak Park High School.
Okay.
And what is your district, by the way? I know it's a lot of – I think it's most of Clay County, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct?
It's most of the population in Clay County. It's southwestern Clay County, so it's Kansas City North and then like Gladstone, Liberty, North Kansas City, Pleasant Valley, Clay Como, those areas there.
And do you I've always wondered is where exactly do you reside? Do you reside in Kansas City proper or do you reside in one of those other towns?
No, I actually live in the city of Kansas City. I live about as far north as you can get. It's actually closer for me to get to Smithville than downtown, but I'm in the city limits.
Now, before we kind of get into what our main topic is, you were actually, before you were elected, an aide to Senator Kit Bond. One of our other guests was as well, Catherine Hanaway. What did
Yes.
he kind of teach you about politics and how did he kind of, what did he kind of teach you in your political career before you actually were in elected office?
You know, he has taught me so much and it was really just from observing him. One of my favorite stories was when I first worked for him, I used to deal with students when they would come out. And if he was busy, I would meet with them instead. And during the TWA American Airlines merger, the conference room was full of airline execs waiting on the senator. And I had some students out front. And when he came in to go to his airline meeting, he stopped and he came over to the table. And he probably spent half an hour with these students, asking him questions the whole bit. And then he said, well, these guys have been waiting. I probably ought to get into that meeting. So later I asked him about that. I said, what was that about? I mean, you had all these really important people waiting for you. Of course, I was right out of college. And he said, the way I look at it, those people will sit at that table all day and wait to talk to me. And if they don't get to talk to me today, they'll be back tomorrow. But those kids may never get a chance to come back to Washington. And maybe something I said will have a difference in their lives. And it really touched me that it's not always what we think is the most important thing that really is the most important thing. Sometimes it's the little things and how you can touch somebody's life.
Well, that does seem
like
a good lesson.
That's true. That's true about many things in life.
Yeah, he's been an amazing mentor for me to look up to and to learn from just by observation.
Well, that's actually a good segue into our chief topic, which is the Medicaid expansion, since former Senator Bond is now one of the key players in the effort by the Missouri Chamber and some others to persuade the General Assembly to change its mind regarding Medicaid expansion. How big of a role has he had and how influential has he been in your taking your position? Because I know you have come up with this alternative bill, which we're going to talk about.
Yeah, it's interesting. Of course, I had been a pretty outspoken opponent of the idea from a cost perspective, having been the House Budget Chairman and now the Vice Chairman of Senate Appropes, that I didn't think it was affordable or sustainable for us to do. And so when he first came to meet with me about it, you know, we talked through those issues and why I felt that way about it. And, you know, we kind of talked about if there was going to be any way to move forward, you had to solve that problem first. You had to make sure that it wasn't going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars to Missouri taxpayers to make it work. And, you know, having him there has been helpful for me because obviously he's somebody that I respect immensely, but I also know that he has a tremendous amount of knowledge about policy and about the process from all of his time in service, and I trust him. And when I said these are the things that need to be addressed, these are the things that we have to solve, he didn't just say no and try to convince me to do something else. He said, you're right. How do you think we should go about doing those things? And so the fact that he was more of a facilitator of the solution rather than him coming in and saying, well, this is how it should be, and you should just agree with me and then get other people to agree with me, it wasn't that way at all. It was very collaborative.
So tell us a little bit about this proposal. And I want to just stress that because filing for bills, I guess, has passed, this is not necessarily a bill, but this is mainly like a proposal that may end up either coming out next year or being attached as an amendment. Kind of explain what this proposal is and kind of how it's different from just straight up Medicaid expansion.
Sure. Well, the first thing is the cost factor. You know, I felt very strongly that we had to not put the Missouri taxpayers on the hook for this thing. And so I kind of looked at how there are certain populations that are on Medicaid today that we pay a 40% match for that under the Affordable Care Act would be able to be shifted to a 100% match, which scales down to 90. So there are several populations that you can do that with and essentially track the savings. And you may have heard that from the governor's office or from some others. But what I've done is said, okay, well, we're going to take the money we are already spending on these populations and divert them into a fund that I've called the Budget Protection Fund. That fund will then continue to accrue a balance over the next several years. When the state has to start paying its match of the when the 100% match goes away, excuse me, we will go to that fund to pay the state's portion of the match. So it's money that already would have been spent on Medicaid in the first place, so no new additional dollars. But then beyond that, I wanted a backstop and said, okay, well, what if the projections are wrong? Because I'm not a big fan of legislating on projections, particularly when you need hard numbers in the budget. So I said, what if it's wrong? In that case, it triggers reductions in payments to the providers. So essentially the hospitals who stand to benefit financially from having less uncompensated care are the ones who would be picking up any of the state's match over and above what was in the fund.
Just for our knowledge of our listeners, basically, under the Medicaid expansion as it stands now in any state, the federal government has promised to pick up all the costs of the expansion for the first 4 years, beginning this year, 2014, and then it scales down to 90%. So the federal government would be covering at least 90% of the costs thereafter. At least that is the plan as stipulated in the Affordable Care Act. I'm just laying that out so our listeners understand. Now, if this doesn't happen this year in Missouri, and let's say some sort of compromise happens in 2015, the state, unless the federal government changes something, the state would still be out the first year of that 3-year all costs covered by the federal government. This is just, I'm just laying out the basics so it kind of explains where you're coming from as far as some of the figures you were putting out.
Correct. And that's why it's so important to have that backstop as well, because as we delay this decision and forego that 100% federal funding, that means there's less savings that would be accruing into the Budget Protection Fund.
So one of the things that I noticed, I know that there's been focus on that and I guess some of the changes to food stamps and elsewhere. But I noticed in the outline that you're also including changes to certificate of need and price transparency, which have been big issues of Senator Rob Schaff. So my question is, you know,
Explain certificate of need.
Certificate of need is the process where hospitals get approved, essentially. And it's been kind of it's been an issue with Senator Schaff for a while. I guess a couple of questions. Why do you feel that's important to put it in there? And have you talked with Senator Schaff about this proposal? And if so, what has been his reaction been?
Well, it's been a continuing education process with all of the members. So I have met with him. You know, this is something that is important to what I would say the free market conservative bloc. They feel like there shouldn't be any bureaucratic roadblocks in the way of the healthcare sector, and if the market can support new hospitals or new ambulatory surgery centers or whatever, that it should just be the market that decides those things. And so that was included. Both that and the transparency thing are things that have been pushed by segments of the Republican Party for as long as I've been down here, honestly. And you know, there's some feeling that those policies would introduce overall healthcare savings as far as driving the prices down of healthcare and maybe perhaps bringing them under control. So that's why they were included. As far as my conversations with Senator Schaff, you know, they're ongoing, and I'm hopeful that that we can continue to make progress.
And I focused on him a lot because he's somebody who is virulently opposed to Medicaid expansion but has proposed things himself. So I see like him as a possibility of, you know, if you work with him, maybe down the road you get something like your bill. But then there are like people like Senator Lamping and Senator Emery, who I'm sure you know are just opposed to it basically by philosophy. So my question is, you know, how do you deal with people who are just going to be opposed to this no matter what, even when you like explain all of these safeguards and facets of the bill that may be comforting to some people?
Well, I think, you know, from a procedural process, you try to address everyone's concerns as best you can. And for those that you're never going to agree with or that aren't going to agree with any solution of any kind whatsoever, you try to get that number as small as possible. if we're in a situation where, you know, there's 5 to 10 senators that want to block it, well, then that's pretty near insurmountable. But if there's 1 or 2, then it becomes a question of, you know, where does the caucus want to go and what do we think we're getting out of it? And is it worth sitting around for a few hours while a couple people talk?
Now, is there any effect of some of the compromise proposals that have been done, let's say in Arkansas and a couple other states that initially had been resistant, but then they've come around by trying to craft something that would satisfy the federal requirements about what has to be done in order to get the federal match, but also at least appear to address some of the conservative concerns about the program in general? Has there been much influence from these other states? Is some of the opposition, in your view, it's philosophical and it's not going to change regardless? I'm just interested in your assessment.
Yeah, it's been really interesting to watch because obviously in crafting this proposal, we looked at all the other states that have tried to move forward and figured out what we thought worked or what we thought didn't or what would work here. And, you know, certainly Indiana, Arkansas, Iowa, Pennsylvania, they're all things that we've looked at. And, you know, that's one thing that in addition to the Budget Protection Fund, what do you do with these people that makes it different than Medicaid? And, you know, a portion of them would be put into the private insurance market using the federal money as premium assistance. And then the rest of the populations would be on some sort of managed care program similar to what we have in the I-70 corridor right now. But what's interesting to me is I look around the country and I look at someone like Governor Pence, who is
Mike Pence of Indiana, so people know he's a former member of Congress. Go ahead.
Yes, extraordinarily conservative gentleman, someone who was vehemently opposed to the ACA while he was in Congress, voted against it multiple times. But they have found a way to make proposals via the Healthy Indiana program, and he seems to be getting no pushback, or at least very little pushback from within his own state. But then I take a conglomeration of several ideas and put forth something that I would argue is even more conservative than the Healthy Indiana proposal. And to some segments in the state here, I'm considered now a liberal who's embracing Barack Obama's agenda.
Yeah. Well, so. Is some of this related to just strong opposition to President Barack Obama and his administration, or because we have a Democratic governor, Jay Nixon? Is that playing into some of this, do you think?
You know, I think the opposition to Obamacare is a lot of it. I mean, both political and philosophical. You know, the state's had a couple of different votes on aspects of the ACA. And I think that gets confused and used as a soundbite a lot, that, you know, the state's voted
against. Oh, the Prop C, yes.
Yeah, I mean, one of them was strictly limited to opposing the individual mandate, which I personally oppose, and the state voted overwhelmingly to oppose. But we can't do anything about that. One of them was the creation of a state exchange through the governor using his executive authority outside of the legislature, which I voted to put on the ballot, which I voted for when it was on the ballot. But neither of those votes address the idea of how do we actually solve the problems that this federal law is creating for us, particularly when it comes to funding in the healthcare sector. So it's funny to me to hear these people parrot this, you know, the states voted against Obamacare twice. Well, yes, but the states voted specifically against two sections of Obamacare, not on this particular solution or this policy that I'm putting forth today.
Now, is there any discussion about the fact that many of the ideas that are in Obamacare initially were advanced by conservative groups like the Heritage Foundation and not particularly Democratic ideas to begin with?
Yeah, I mean, that doesn't really seem to come up very much. You know, one thing that I pointed out the other day on the Senate floor was what I'm proposing is not terribly dissimilar to something that Governor Matt Blunt proposed.
In Sure, Missouri.
And in Sure, Missouri was, in fact, passed out of the Missouri Senate and was carried by a version of it was carried by Senator Schaaf while he was a member of the House.
Yeah, and the bugaboo on that was certificate of need, which I know we're running a little bit low on time, but I was thinking about that when I was looking at your proposal, and I'm wondering whether the hospitals bear some responsibility for the failure of that, because if they would have accepted changes to certificate of need, that would have passed and been implemented, and maybe we'd be having a completely different conversation right now.
Well, we definitely would be having a different conversation, because in Sure, Missouri, if I remember right, went up to 120% of poverty. So we would have, before the ACA, covered, but you know, we're at 18% now, but with Sure, Missouri, we would have been at 120%. So it would have been a completely different dynamic had Sure, Missouri passed back a few years ago.
Yeah, I mean, because for our listeners, we have to cover 138% of poverty level in order to qualify for federal money.
Yes. So my final question for you, what do you think the prospects are for this proposal? Do you think it'll pass this year, or do you think this is a wait till next year sort of thing?
You know, I think that there's a slim possibility. I mean, one of the famous sayings around here is nothing's ever dead in the Missouri Senate. So I think that there's a slim possibility that it gets done this year. There's still 5 weeks left for the dynamic to change. But one thing that has happened through me pushing this proposal forward is the discussion has changed in that next year it doesn't seem like such a big deal.
Hmm. Why?
You know, all of a sudden, where I originally felt like there's no way we would ever do this, now I, along with most of my colleagues, feel like, well, once people get more comfortable with it and understand the differences between what ACA says and what my proposal is and how we treat the populations differently, how we protect the Missouri taxpayers, once we get everyone comfortable with those things, I think there'll be much less resistance to it next year, and it's probably more likely to happen.
What are you hearing from the House regarding feedback? Because so far the perception has been that the House is strongly against any proposal having to do with Medicaid expansion. So even if your proposal were to get through the Senate, it might not go anywhere. What are you hearing?
Yeah, I don't get that same sense. I mean, remember Representative Torpey has worked a number of these ideas into legislation on the House side. Representative Barnes has been assisting in that effort. So I think that the interim committees and all of the the discussion that has taken place on how we should reform the entire Medicaid system has been beneficial both in the House and the Senate. I think that if they were to get a reform proposal that included many of the reforms they're talking about, but actually had a way to get the waivers needed from the federal government, I think that they would look hard at it, and I think it probably would pass. I think what's interesting is if you took the proposal I've put forward and you put it on the floor of the Senate today and got a vote today, I wholeheartedly believe it would pass. And I believe it would also pass on the floor of the House.
Really?
Now, the challenge is getting it to a vote.
Yes, absolutely, because as our listeners know, the filibuster in the Senate is very powerful. So if you have 5 or 10 people filibustering it, even if you have 18 votes, it's tough to overcome.
And in the House, the leadership has to agree to have something come up for a floor vote.
Absolutely. You probably correct. Have to run to the Senate right now. It's 4:03. The Senate has been gaveled into 4. So we appreciate your time today. Just to close this out, you can follow me on Twitter at Jay Rosenbaum. You can follow Joe Mannies at
Jay Mannies. It's J-M-A-N-N-I-E-S.
And you can follow the senator at?
At Ryan Silvey.
All right. Thank you very much.
All righty. Thank you for having me on.
And thank you.
The Gateway brings you the day's news from the St. Louis region and across Missouri. It also includes stories from the Illinois side of the river and our Metro East reporter, Will Bauer.
In Alton, in Belleville, in East St. Louis, in Edwardsville, in Cahokia Heights, at Scott Air Force Base, I'm Will Bauer, St. Louis Public Radio.
Listen to reports from Will and all of our journalists weekdays on the Gateway, on the STLPR app, and wherever you get podcasts.